of the individuals that have passed from this disease. It's still too many. So today, we're taking the step forward. Let me introduce you to my wonderful colleague and leader, president of Queens Medical Center, chief operating officer for the Queens Health System, and he's been the incident commander for our work at Queens as it relates to COVID since the beginning of the epidemic, and has done a magnificent job of helping us plan and move forward and meet your needs. Jason.
Thank you. I just want to say thank you, everyone, for your interest in coming out today to just really memorialize this first day. I think I'm excited, and everybody that's worked here at Queens over the past year has put in a lot of hours, timeless hours, energy and sacrifice, preparing our state to take care of the COVID patients. And over this course, we know that we've taken care of some of the sickest, and we've seen some of the most devastating scenarios. That's why this is so exciting. And so I think the most important thing is that this is the start, and hopefully it allows us to turn the corner. From a logistics standpoint, we will start giving vaccinations beyond today. Tomorrow will be the first official day here at Punch Bowl. We have secured 4 sub-zero freezers within our health system. One will be located at West Oahu, 2 of them here, and we have 1 coming to North Hawaii Community Hospital, which will allow us to expand our ability to store and vaccinate populations across the entire state. So we're excited about that. And we don't forget Molokai. Molokai, we will coordinate making sure that the healthcare providers and the entire island have access to the vaccinations. And so that's an exciting piece. We're happy to be leaders in the vaccination effort. I think the other piece is that we have also expanded ourselves to offering vaccinations to our community health providers, local EMS, fire department, and others that are considered essential in the front line. I think that's important because everybody in the entire community is essential to us, and we want to make sure that we can broadly and quickly get vaccinations out to everyone across the organization in the entire state. So we're happy to answer any questions, but really thank you for coming and just sharing the first 5 within the Queens Health Organization that have volunteered to be vaccinated. So it's exciting, so thank you.
So the first 5 today, and then when will we start seeing the bulk of the vaccines be given out? I know there's 975 you got yesterday, and you're expecting another shipment tomorrow.
Yep, so we are starting actually vaccinating broader populations tomorrow in the morning. And a lot of it is making sure that we can do it safely, and we are constituting the vaccinations. A lot of it is learning the logistics. So much information came to us very quickly, and the team has worked almost tirelessly over the last week preparing ourselves, making sure that we're ready. And as soon as we can ramp ourselves up, we will do so, but we expect that to be very soon. We do, and that's actually one of the most important things, making sure that if somebody does have side effects, what to look for. That's part of the pre-education and then also the post-follow-up. Our COVID hotline, which has been stood up, it's the same number, the 691-2619, that everyone in the community has had access to since the beginning of the pandemic. You call that line, it's staffed by nurses and physicians, and they'll answer the questions and evaluate, you know, what the next medical steps are. Yeah, I think because this is under emergency use authorization, that everything is going to be tightly controlled, and they want to know all the symptoms. It's part of getting the full FDA approval.
Once you get the full FDA approval, will you make it mandatory for workers?
We do not intend to. We believe that once people see the efficacy and the rate of side effects, then they will self-select. And our organization, when it comes to flu shot, 90%, over 9% choose to electively get the flu shot. So we believe that they'll follow suit.
What's on the agenda for these folks getting the vaccine today for the rest of the day? Are they supposed to monitor their symptoms? Are they going to work? What are they doing?
Yep, monitor symptoms. From all indications, the first injection has very few side effects. And so the anticipation is that you know, people will be able to go about their day, but definitely monitor their symptoms.
How do you choose who's next?
So it's based on those that are on the front line. And so a little bit systematic, because we don't want everyone in one unit to get the vaccination all at one time. But we do want to broadly and widely get the vaccination to those on the front line, and then systematically get through the entire organization as fast as possible.
Any particular departments that are like, must go first?
Yeah, we definitely said that those are in the emergency department, those that are working on our COVID unit, those in the medical ICU, which is our COVID ICU, are among those on the front.
How many employees do you have at Queens? And is there a sign-up system as to who wants to get the vaccine?
Yeah, so there are 5,800 here at the Punch Bowl campus, and there's almost 8,000 across the organization. And there is a sign-up system. It's using the state's recommended or mandated system, the VAMS system.
How many people have signed up?
I don't know. That's a good question. We just opened it up now.
Did you guys do any surveying prior to vaccination to see the interest from staff members?
So we did have some polling going on amongst all of our employees, and it showed somewhere in the range of 70% that were interested in the vaccine. But we do believe that there's others that, when we went out and actually spoke to people, that may have been a little worried. They just didn't want to get it on the first day, but we're happy to get it, you know, in week two.
Do you expect shipments to come, you know, every week or so, or will there be lulls in between on when more shipments are coming, and do you know how many total you'll be receiving at one time?
Yeah, so we expect that shipments will come weekly, and indications, we're still working with the Department of Health on how many we're going to get. We do believe that our second order is about 5,000 that will be arriving, and I'm not sure what the state's going to receive in total.
And to be clear, is everyone here going back to work after this?
Probably so, yes.
And another clarification, you guys are the first time because we volunteered to be the first line.
Correct.
What kind of public education are you doing to the broader community to get them to buy into this?
Yeah, I think that, you know, this is the first step. But a rather comprehensive education program. I think the first piece is, because it's not available to those in the community, we don't want to create you know, false information. But as soon as we know that we will have vaccinations and a plan and guidance from the Department of Health to begin vaccinating the community, then we want to make sure there's broad education and awareness. Hope next week. Yep.
Okay, we're gonna start with our vaccination process. If Jill and Jason want to also flank the table, so you can our first person, first in Hawaii, we're very excited. Dr. Lester Moorhead, he is a hospitalist here. He works with COVID patients. The vaccine is gonna be administered by Ruby Takahashi with our employee health department.
Is it cool to put it, because the mic's over here,
it's
radio? Yeah, So can you say and spell your name and also, I guess, position so that we have it all known?
Sure, I'm one of the hospitalists. My name is Lester Moorhead, LesterMoorehead.
What are your day-to-day activities at the hospital? How do you interact with COVID patients?
I'm on the COVID unit.
And what does that entail?
It's an inpatient unit, so when people get so sick from COVID-19 that they need to be admitted to the hospital, they come to the COVID unit or the ICU, and I work in the COVID unit, not the ICU.
How do you feel being the first person in Hawaii to get this COVID-19?
I'm honored. I want others to get it too.
What made you want to be the first person?
Everyone needs to get it. And I ask everybody to do it. I just want people to follow me.
What is your message to people who might be fearful of getting the vaccine?
That's fair. It's okay to be concerned. It's very fair to be concerned. But I'm confident in the science. I believe in it. And I assure you we need to end this. And this is the best way we can do it.
Do you have any anxiety right now? With
my biggest fear is that people won't get the vaccine.
And are you from Hawaii or are you a traveling hospitalist?
No, I live here, but I'm not originally from here.
How long have you been working at Queens?
About 5 years.
And talk about your time. I know we're kind of in a downswing for COVID in Hawaii, but a few months ago, the situation was very different. Talk about what this virus can do.
Die alone? Yeah. It could do anything. You just don't know. It has such a wide impact on people's health, and you don't know how it's going to impact you. And don't just think about yourself. The biggest thing that we see is families get sick. Families come in. And you don't want to do that. You don't want to be the one that accidentally passes it on to someone else. And we have the ability to stop it. And this is how you do it.
And did the shot just feel like any other flu shot?
That's good.
Nothing good?
Nothing. Feels optimistic.
Can we move along and maybe we'll vaccinate the other four, bang, 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 and then you guys can ask the questions later. Okay, so next up, we have an RN from our medical intensive care unit, Deborah Lakata. Going to be vaccinated by our interim system director of infection prevention and control, Linda Bunce. We'll also send you all the name spellings after the meeting.
Yes.
who's going to get vaccinated. Yay! Marilyn Marcelino will be vaccinated by Linda Bach.
That's our infectious disease unit, our COVID unit.
Thank you.
I want to say to all of you, thank you. Thank you for educating the community. Thank you for being the first. And most importantly, thank you for what you do every day.
Sure. My name is Deborah Licata, L-I-C-H-O-T-A. I am a staff nurse. I work on Tower 4 MICU. Primarily, we've been the COVID ICU. And as I had mentioned to our executive leadership here, that this has probably been one of the most challenging years that I think anyone who's been in nursing for the last 10, 15 years has had. And I know they've ask, like, why did you want to get this? And I will say it has been very exhausting and challenging on numerous levels, because we as nurses want to save and protect lives. And there have been times where we're at our patients' bedsides holding their hands when it should be their families and loved ones with them. We've seen the detrimental outcomes of what this disease does. We've seen people who were once very strong become just a fraction of the person that they were. And we need to get a hold of this. This doesn't mean that once you get the vaccine, you don't have to wear your mask and you don't have to wash your hands. It's still needing that, but we need to do something to help prevent the spread of this. And that has been one of the greatest pushes to get this done. We are a community, and that's where we need to get out there and start protecting and helping each other out. And hopefully this is the big footstep in the right way to do that. So, yeah.
Can we talk about a little bit about, you know, this is kind of the light kind of at the end of the tunnel, maybe?
So for my generation, this has probably been one of the biggest pandemics that we've seen. And through the last probably century and a half, we've had it. We just, our population hasn't been as large. And so I think for us, when we see this as the light at the end of the tunnel, it is. We saw it 100 years ago with the flu pandemic, how it wiped out people. 50 plus years ago, we had polio. Our state alone also had its own epidemic or pandemic in which we were separated from family and loved ones. And then we were able to find a cure for that. And that's where we're at right now. So I think we need to continue to push through and encourage people to, you know, get the vaccine because it is available. And we've seen what it can do for our population and to prevent diseases that can be so detrimental and deadly.
Anything else you want to say to non-believers?
You know, I have been at the bedside, and there is, it frustrates me. I wish that they could see the loss of someone's light when they get this sick. I have been there when somebody is just gasping in order to say their name, and we are rushing to give them everything to be able to give them life. If they could just see that and know that, it's not 1% of the population. There are long-term effects that are gonna haunt these people forever, and that is why these non-believers need to see it. I wish they could, because that is the only way that they will fully understand how severe this disease is.
My name is Charlene Pang, and I work on the COVID unit on Tower 9 Diamond Head. Charlene, last name is Pang, P-A-N-G.
You want to just describe what it's been like over the past so many months? What anything profound or anything that stands out in your mind in terms of what you witness?
So these patients come in and they're very, very sick. Some of them can't breathe. And, you know, we're at the front line, we're at the bedside trying to help them and do everything that we can so that, you know, they can get better. And some of them don't. They suffer. Some of them die. And, you know, we're the ones having to have been dealing with this for the past months, and it's exhausting, it's tiring. There's so much feelings of and emotions, stress that a lot of the frontline healthcare workers have to face every single day when we come into work, when we go home. It's overwhelming.
So something like today, I mean, what was the feeling?
I I was just, you know, honored to be able to be one of the first from our organization to get this vaccine. And I just hope that many other employees and people decide to get the vaccine as well. I mean, if we can help to save one life, that's all it's going to take. Yes, so being on the front line, I have two young children. One is going to be 8 and the other one is 4. And, you know, they haven't been able to live a normal life. They can't go out when they want to. We have to take so much precautions. My son plays sports, and not being able to do those, you know, normal things that we used to do prior to COVID, it's just really hard on the kids, and it's hard on my family. My father has, you know, medical conditions, and it's really hard to, you know, live with all of these restrictions. So by taking this vaccine, I'm hoping that, you know, we do see the light at the end of the tunnel and that we overcome this pandemic.